Easter Sunday. He is risen indeed. So glad to have you here today.
Thank you all for joining us today. We are ecstatic that you've chosen to celebrate Easter at First Church. Right after service, we'll be having an egg hunt for the kids. Two and under are inside the building, and then three and over are outside. So make sure as soon as service is over, if you want to watch your kiddos go hunt for amazing, amazing Easter egg hunts, please join us outside in the fields, and they'll direct you where to go. Thank you so much for being with us on Easter Sunday.
Next Sunday begins the Chosen series. You don't want to miss this. We have the producers of the Chosen here with us next Sunday. That unfolds or begins to unfold 8 weeks on the life and the gospel of Jesus Christ. You'll get your books and promos. Be here next Sunday.
Please join with us for the 2 months of the Chosen series. You're going to love it. And again, thank you so much for joining us for Easter at First Church. We are honored that you have chosen First Church to celebrate this amazing day.
believe that the living God is here today and alive and moving in this house. Amen. Miracles are going to happen today. Let's believe it together.
You do everything on purpose. I can feel your spirit stir. I've been praying, you've been working it all for good.
Come on, help us see this.
Fan the flame and keep it burning. You're refining in the furnace. All the waiting with
celebrate your power over the grave. We celebrate your power over sickness. We celebrate your power over depression and over fear and over everything that would plague your people today. We cry out to you, O living Savior. We love you this morning. We declare your glory. We declare your victory. And we declare your dominance over everything in this house today. In Jesus' name. Now we speak over every person here today, every person watching, every person whose heart is turned towards you this morning. Lord, miracle after miracle, that's our testimony. And we declare that today will be no exception to that. In the house, watching online, all over the world, celebrating your goodness today, we declare you are Lord of all. In Jesus' name, be Lord in this house today. Be glorified in this house today. And we expect all of your miraculous power on display today because you are so good. In Jesus' name. How about lifting a huge round of praise to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords this morning? Welcome to Easter Sunday. God bless you.
Are you happy to be in His presence this morning? Let's give Him a praise. Thank you, Jesus. Welcome to Easter at First Church. Before you're seated, I'm going to ask you to do that annoying thing that you always get asked to do. And it's not turn to your neighbor and greet them. It is if you could move in and leave some seats on the end. We've still got cars in the parking lot of people that are trying to get in. So if you don't mind, before you're seated, if there are empty seats, if you can squeeze in so we can get some moms with strollers onto an end row. This is a good problem, right? And while we're talking about good problems, today when you leave, you will only be able to make a right turn, and we are doing that for your safety. So please listen to the police officers that are out there. Watch the parking team. They are going to kind of help you get out of here in an easy way this morning. Thank you so much for being here. Now you can turn to your neighbors, say hello to our online family. Thank you so much for joining us today at Easter at First Church. Okay, you can have a seat. I feel like we could probably lose the service right here. Make sure you squeeze in and leave some empty seats on the rows. Thank you so much for being here. We are honored to have each and every one of you. It looks amazing in here today, and we are so thankful that you chose to celebrate such a special day with First Church. Right after this service, there will be an Easter egg hunt for all the kids. So if you want to see your kids get muddy in the fields in their cute little Easter outfits, this is for you. This is what you bought them for, so they could go run around in the mud and pick up eggs. And so if you want to watch them, they'll be out in the fields. Look for the signs. Two and under are going to be inside, but that's going to be happening right after service. So as soon as we're done in here, if you want to slip out and see your kids go ruin the clothes that you hopefully got a picture of before service instead of after, this is your moment. Thank you so much for being here today. I want to tell you a little bit about what's going on in the next 2 months. So I'm sure you've seen the sign out front that we have got the Chosen series starting the first Sunday of April with the Chosen producers will be here with us in the house. And then we've got 2 months where we are going to focus on the life of Jesus Christ. Because how many of you know that we are living in a world that the only hope is the revelation of Jesus Christ right now? You know, I look around and I think, God, I know you know what's going on. I know you're aware. And we need a revelation of the love of Jesus Christ, the message of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we are going to be doing that through the Chosen series for the next 2 months. We've got an amazing book that we're going to be handing out to where you can take notes. It's going to tell you the next sermon series that you, or the next Sunday service that you can kind of read up on the scriptures, that you can watch the episodes that are relevant to that next Sunday. So we want you to come and just pour your life into the next 2 months. And I'm going to make you a promise that if you're struggling in this place and you haven't found a purpose, or you haven't found a calling, or you haven't found connection, if you'll commit to 2 months of Sunday services where you say, I'm going to give it all I've got. For 2 months, I'm going to be faithful, I'm going to give my all, and I'm going to learn to be more like Jesus. I promise you won't recognize who you are after those 2 months are through. I promise you won't recognize who you've become. God is able to do amazing things, and we are going to focus on the one who gave all for us, and that's what we're celebrating today. So I want to turn your attentions to the screens, watch the short promo, and thank you for being at Easter at First Church.
Hey, I'm Chris June.
And I'm Chad Gunderson, and we are the executive producers of The Chosen.
Please join us Sunday morning, April 7th at First Church, where we're coming to just discuss what it's been like to be on this journey of The Chosen and to just share our hearts.
We can't wait to meet you, First Church. Look forward to it.
How many of you are looking forward to The Chosen series? Amen. It was in a labor union meeting in London a few years back. The word church was mentioned and the crowd began to boo. Then someone mentioned Jesus and the crowd began to cheer. I read one translation recently that said to give glory to God means to make him famous. Here's what we're going to do the next 2 months. We're going to make Jesus famous in this part of Houston. We're going to make him famous. We're going to lift up our hearts and our hands to the one that loved us all. And here we are on this most pivotal day of the church calendar on Resurrection Sunday. What a day to make him famous. What a day to talk about the one who triumphed over death, hell, and the grave and gave you and I the victory. Can you say amen to that? We do welcome you here today and so happy that you are here. And just believe that something momentous is going to take place in today's service. It could be in a song, could be in the message, it could be in our time of prayer, but something pivotal is going to happen to each and every one of us. And we're going to leave with the hope of resurrection power in our hearts and in our lives. Can you say amen to that? Going to ask you to stand. Part of our worship, ushers, if you come, is in our giving. Here we are on the last day of the first quarter of the year. It's hard to believe that a fourth of the year has passed us by already. I'm looking at a group of people, though, that I believe you know God has been good to us. He's been very good to us. And today we're celebrating the one who held nothing back but gave his all. The Bible says he was poured out like a drink offering before the Lord, emptied in totality, that he could rise again and bring with him you and me and give us the freedom that only his presence can give. What we do as unto the Lord. Everything we do in faith, the Bible says, is not a sin. What we don't do in faith is a sin. We give in faith, saying, you're my provider. You take care of me. And everything we give in these offerings go around the world. We were on a conference call just day before yesterday with two different nations, the largest nation of the world and the nation that is experiencing the most revival in the world. The leaders of those two nations talking to each other, planning to get them together in a week or so. And we believe, we felt the presence of the Lord. God speak to us, saying God is about to pour out his spirit in these nations, and it's your offerings that made all of that possible. So thank you. I want to pray a prayer of blessing over each and every one of you before these all ushers receive your offering. Let's just pray together. Father, I thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh. You provide each and every need in this building. No matter what we brought into this house, God, your all sufficiency is capable of providing our needs. I ask you, open up the windows of heaven right now and pour on everybody in this building a blessing. If they need strength, let them receive it. If they need healing, let them receive it. If they have a dilemma in their life and need a solution, let it happen right now, God. And we'll be careful to give you the praise, and we ask all of these things in the name of Jesus. And can Saul, everyone say amen. Ushers, go right ahead. Let's continue in our worship. Just remain standing. One moment, in the twinkling of an eye, on a Sunday morning, bad news became good news. Law became gospel. Lungs breathed again. A once broken heart began to beat anew. A dormant voice was no longer silenced. The same voice that brought light into darkness, that turned chaos into cosmos, that enveloped the totality of death and dying into the chrysalis of hope. That voice echoes through time and eternity, saying, neither death nor life, nor angels or principalities, not the present nor the future, nothing can stop me and nothing can stop you. you are more than a conqueror. Because he lives, you shall live also. Because his power rests in you, you are free. Free to overcome. Free to be healed. Free to become what he intends. That voice speaks today, saying, call it by a name. And my name is higher than that name. So let the walls fall. Let the seas part. Let the storms stay. Let the night flee. Let the stone roll. Today, gravity is defied. On nail-scarred feet, he rose again and shouts for all to hear. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and of death.
Stronghold shall be broken. You thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Oh, and all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb.
Come on, your name.
Your name is the highest.
Your name
is the greatest.
Your name,
Jesus,
stands above them all.
Above all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, creation cry.
Sing the song forever to the land. worship our risen King.
Yes.
that the grave is still empty. The stone is still up. Come on, sing it out with me. You're still high, lifted up. You're still seated on the cross. The cross still stands, yes it does. The blood still flows. The work is finished, and hell still knows that the grave is still empty. The stone is still rolled. You're still high and lifted up. You're still seated on the cross. Oh, praise, oh, praise. Praise to your name, oh, Jesus. Jesus reigns. Oh, everybody. Happy Easter indeed. There is no better Sunday. Every Sunday is good, but there's no better Sunday than the day that we celebrate the resurrection of our Savior. There is no better Sunday than this Sunday to say He is worthy of the highest praise. He is worthy of everything I can give Him because He has been so good to me. If you feel that way, can you lift praise from your heart? From your hands, from your voice. Jesus, we give you all the glory. We give you all the glory. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for being here. I want you to take just a second. I want you to turn and look around you. We got a wonderful problem in this place this morning. We are out of chairs. Yeah. They just sent me a picture. They're bringing chairs out of storage in the event center. They don't match. If you're one of those people that like aesthetic things bother you, I'm sorry that the chairs we're bringing in now don't match the other chairs. Please try to tune it out and forgive us. It's the best problem you can have in a church. We are thankful that you're all here. They texted me, we're still parking people, so I don't know what they wanted me to do about it, but we're still parking people. So if you got seats beside you, wave at people, tell them to come sit with you, whatever. I don't know what the poor musicians and singers are going to do today. They can sit on the floor. I don't know. We'll figure it out. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Happy Easter. Smile at somebody around you. Tell them you are glad to see them. And then if you got a chair, you can be seated in it. You can be seated. Thank you so much for being in the house of the Lord at First Church on Easter Sunday. We are thrilled to have you. And I need to ask you, before we get too far into this, to just trust me, okay? Do you trust me? All right. Because I'm going to give you my title first, and I need you to promise me that you are not going to tune out for the next 15 minutes trying to figure out what exactly it is that I'm talking about. We will get there in due time. I want to preach to you on this Easter Sunday, Christ, the cross, and cake mix. I told you. You see how jarring that is? It doesn't belong. It doesn't go. That's the point. It's not poetic. You've got somber and majestic, Christ and the cross. The reason we're here today, placed beside the mundane cake mix. I am
already breaking all of the rules for a very professional Easter sermon. And I apologize. But in that jarring statement, Christ, the cross, and cake mix, is a stark reality. God has always been in the business of positioning himself in the context of contradiction, always. From the beginning of his story, that a baby in a manger, weak and meek and mild, could be the very embodiment of supernatural strength, it makes no sense. Or that Jesus could somehow be fully God and fully man at the same time. That he was a conquering king, but he's wearing carpenter's robes. Makes no sense. That we would look today with modern eyes and that a cross, an instrument of torture and death, could somehow become beautiful in the hearts and minds of millions of believers. That a burial that's the end of a story could somehow become the prelude to a victory that's just the beginning of everything, it makes no sense. But God has always done that. Even on this platform right now, this awesome backdrop back here. On the one hand, you've got beauty. On the other hand, you've got ugliness. You've got, on the one hand, this, flowers in bloom. On the other hand, you've got a rugged stone that was placed over a borrowed tomb with a dead man inside it, and somehow that emblem becomes the emblem not of death, but of life. And not just the life of the man who came out of the tomb, but the life of you and the life of me and the life of our families and the life of this church. God has always done it that way. It has been the way of God from the beginning of time to introduce complexity and dichotomy and contradiction into your story and into my story. Now, if you've been around for the last few weeks, you know we've been in a series called Corinthians. And even though it's Easter, I'm going to continue the series, and we're wrapping it up today because we're going to have a blast starting next Sunday. But the whole problem and point that we've pulled out in every sermon of this month, talking about the book of 1 Corinthians and the book of 2 Corinthians, is that the Apostle Paul has written a letter to a church that has a lot of complexity and contradiction on the inside of it. And that's why it catches my attention today on Easter Sunday. You get beyond the midpoint of 1 Corinthians, where Paul has spent chapters talking about that very conflict in the church, the presence and the cause of all the dysfunction that he sees in a church because there's people there. And there's people here. And guess what? We got some of the same issues because you're human and I'm human and we gather together to do a spiritual work in this place on a Sunday morning, but you're still flesh and I'm still flesh and I'm still prone to doing the wrong thing and saying the wrong thing and responding the wrong way because I'm human. But we get together, we come together as a church to build a church, and just because we're serving a holy God doesn't mean that you're holy every day. Or that I'm holy every day. And so Paul is digging into this throughout the book of 1 Corinthians. He is correcting church structure, church leadership, church doctrine. He said your concept of grace is all wrong. You move into chapter 10, we preached about that, about proper worship, what that looks like. Chapter 11, we talked about communion and community, we preached about that. Chapter 12, all the different giftings that are in the body and how they are fitly joined together for us to accomplish what God wants us to accomplish. Then you get to chapter 13. This is the most famous chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians, and it's that thing that goes, love is patient, love is kind, and we read it at weddings a lot because here's the hack for your marriage. Are you ready? You replace the word love with your name and you see how you're doing. Let's try this. When I point at you, you say your name. Okay, let's try it. Are you ready? 1, 2, 3. Is patient. Mm. Don't get, it's a Bible, don't get mad at me. Let's try it again. 1, 2, 3. Is kind. Whew. Again. Never envies. Let's do a couple more. 1, 2, 3. Is never self-promoting. How are we doing, social media influencers? Woo! One more. You're going to love this one. 1, 2, 3. Is never provoked. Your name, you hope all things and you endure all things and you believe. How are we doing out there on Easter Sunday morning? See, what you don't realize is that Paul is creeping closer and closer and closer to the problem that's at the root of the tree in the Corinthian church. Chapter 14, he talks about spiritual giftings and how they're being misused. How the people have come to value speaking in an unknown tongue more than they've come to value speaking in a language people can understand and being kind to one another. Because it doesn't matter if you pray in tongues if you're critical in English all the time. And he wraps all of that up and he says, let everything be done in a way that's edifying, meaning it builds everybody up. Now you close that chapter and you get to 1 Corinthians 15, which I believe is the most predictive and the most prescriptive chapter of the book of 1 Corinthians. It's diagnostic, and it's the resurrection chapter, and it's why we're here closing out this month on Easter Sunday with this chapter. You would almost think that we'd plan an entire series to wrap up where Paul wraps up talking to the church about what resurrection looks like. And if you thought that, you would be right. We did. All right, you're on to us. Let me read you 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which you received, and in which you stand. Meaning, I preached it and you got it. You believed it. You said, yes, I believe that. I'm going to stand on that. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which also I received, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. All right. Now, then he goes on. He talks about, you know, after Jesus was resurrected, he was seen by Cephas, he was seen by the 12, by the 500 brethren, he was seen by James and the apostles. And last, he says, he was even seen by me. I saw him myself. We've all seen him, we've all declared that it's true. He's back, he's resurrected. You've built your faith on believing that. He said, you received it and you stood on that. But if you've been with us throughout this series, you know that the primary problem that Paul is dealing with and digging up in the church is that the culture of Corinth is becoming the culture of the church. There's not much difference between the inside and the outside. The ways of Corinth are becoming the ways of the church. The doubt of Corinth is becoming the doubt inside the church. There's this curious thing that's happening that Paul's diagnosing. The Corinthians have become supernatural cessationists, meaning they believe that Jesus rose from the dead, but they don't believe that anybody else can be raised from the dead. It's a bunch of polytheistic, superstitious people. In the minds of some, Jesus has joined this pantheon of supernatural deities that they worship. He's another piece of their mythology. They have the kind of faith that says, I can believe he did it, but I don't believe he'll do it for me. I can believe that Jesus was raised. We've got stories of other deities that have done supernatural things. They had no trouble believing that that was possible. But when it came down to saying, yes, but can my brother be raised from the dead? They said no. And that's the issue that has arisen in the Corinthian church, and Paul, as Paul tends to do, Paul comes out swinging. Verse 12, now if Christ is preached that he has been raised from the dead, how do some among you say that there is no resurrection of the dead? If there's no resurrection of the dead, then Christ cannot be risen. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is empty and your faith is also empty. Yes, and we are found false witnesses of God because we've testified of God that he raised up Christ, who he didn't raise up, according to you, if in fact the dead do not rise. Now, you're saying that you believe he did, but you're also saying that the dead don't rise. Verse 16, for if the dead rise not, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ is not risen, then your faith is in vain, and you are still dead in your sins. He is preaching to them, hey, church, you can't have it both ways. Now, let me start preaching on this Easter Sunday. Paul is preaching to a church community of believers, they say. They are professing Christians in their shared communal worldview, but they are functional atheists in their personal faith. I believe Jesus was resurrected, but I believe my life will remain a total mess. I believe all of that Jesus stuff was real, but I also believe that my problems are too big for him and too big for the church and too big for the community of believers. That's what he's facing in Corinth. A group of people who said, we have no trouble believing that Jesus was raised from the dead, but we have a whole lot of trouble believing that that same power can work in my own life and in my own family and in my own future. Practically atheists, but professing believers. And he's preaching to the church and he says, you cannot have it both ways. You can't claim faith for this and leave the faith for that laying untouched. You don't get to have it both ways. It is the struggle of culture today. Culture has a lot of room for your Easter attendance, but not much room for your Monday walk. It's got a lot of room for you to come in here today and say, hey, it's Easter Sunday. Everybody that's a believer goes to church on Easter Sunday. But when you start living out your faith on Monday, it's not quite as accepted. It's the reality of today. It's the reality of Corinth. You know that Easter is the most attended Sunday of the year, right? Attended by everybody. Why is that? It's because Easter is the day when every self-identifying Christian, no matter how busy you've been, or you know it's been a while since I've been to church, but it's Easter Sunday, I really need to get there today. So you sacrifice and you push, you survive getting your kids ready, you survive getting your spouse out the door on time, all that stuff. Because it's Easter Sunday, this is what we do. Why? To show the world that we believe in all this Jesus stuff. It matters to us. And I've got faith for that. And I am absolutely thrilled that you're here. It is my sincere prayer that this day, where we have run out of chairs entirely, becomes the floor of a new normal. I hope 6 months from now this is an off attendance. I really do. But do you know what it would take to make that happen? It would take you saying, you know what, I'm going to come back next Sunday too. And then I'm going to come the next Sunday too, because my faith is not in just saying, you know, I believe in this Jesus stuff, but that I am making a change and a commitment in my life today to put my real faith where my mouth is and say, you know what, if it matters on Easter, it matters next Sunday. It matters in April and May and June and July. That's the change. But that's the struggle of culture. Everybody's busy. Everybody's clock and calendar needs a little bit more room in it. I know yours does. I know mine does. That's the reality of the world in which we live. But while I am thrilled that you are here today, as a pastor, I am far more interested in what the daily practices of your life reveal about you tomorrow than I am what your presence here today says about you. I am more interested in tomorrow than I am in today. I flipped on the Astros game the other night, and probably because of the Ultra HD cameras from Apple TV, the vivid picture really stood out. I saw a player with a chain and a cross. And I think it's not supposed to be on the outside, but he'd gotten a little worked up and the cross came out. And he is going off on the umpire. Now, I couldn't hear him. But I have a feeling that if I could have heard him, there would have been bleeps. He was not happy at all. See, the cross indicated I possess a Christian worldview. But in this moment, the worldview was not reflected in the behavior. I don't know what he was saying. He was not praying the rosary. I do know that. He was not teaching a Bible study to the umpire. His professed identity did not match his performed behavior. Are you tracking with me? Are we there? All right. And Paul is saying to the Corinthian church, you can't have it both ways. You can't have Jesus on a shelf. You can't have Jesus on a chain and say, I like that. And that same living Christ not change the way you think and the way you act and the way you hope and the way you behave and the way you respond. So if you're stuck in your storm and you're stuck in chaos and you're stuck in depression or whatever it is, and you're at the place where you're thinking there's no hope. I don't know if I can even survive this. I don't even know if I can still be saved. It'll never change. Not here, not now, not in my family, not in my mind. And if we are honest with each other, all of us as believers all come to that point sometimes where I know the God that I serve is all powerful, but I also know the reality of what I'm facing in the moment. The problem is that my moments don't always line up with my worldview. The reality of what I'm facing doesn't always look like the cross on the chain. It looks like an impossibility in which, yes, I still believe in Jesus, but I've also got enough common sense to know that this one is difficult, and doubt starts creeping in. If that is the final answer, that it's always going to be this way, if that is the end of the story, then we are wasting our time, and we are dead in our sins, and nobody is coming to save us because Jesus is still dead, if that's true. If your problem, no matter how difficult, no matter how gripping it is, if it can't be fixed, then Jesus is still dead and we're wasting our time on a Sunday morning. We better find something else to do. But Paul said, if you can believe that Jesus Christ can be raised and your presence here today indicates that you believe enough in Easter to get yourself up and get to the house of God, if you've got the faith to believe that, then on the worst day of your life, even when you don't feel it, can I tell you that you also have the faith to believe that Jesus Christ can open the door in your life? He can fix your problem. He can answer your prayers. He can rearrange your future. He can release you from the guilt and shame of your past. You can't have it both ways. You can't have faith for this and not hang on to faith for that. But see, we live in that context of contradiction. It's beautiful over here. It's rocky over here. Things look good over here on Sunday morning. You're suited up and smiling and saying, oh, everything's great. And you know it's not because you're living on this side. But there's a contradiction underneath it all. But if Christ is alive, if you believe that Jesus Christ is alive, and if you believe that he could see a miracle, a resurrection in his own life, then can I tell you today, and I know this is simple, but can I tell you that every dead thing, every closed door, every difficulty in your life can also see the same power at work, the same resurrection that raised him up can raise you up? You got to believe that. Yesterday, we were cleaning up because we got kids, and what you do mostly when you're at home is you clean up. You know that, right? Like, that's what your house is for. It's just a thing to be cleaned all the time. And the more kids you have, the more cleaning it requires. All right. So we've bagged up some trash. We got some boxes, probably Amazon. Y'all, do Amazon boxes just show up at your house? I don't know where they're coming from. I'm not ordering it. My kids don't have account. I'm going to get in trouble on Easter Sunday. Packed up the Amazon boxes, bagged up the trash. Now send the kids outside, And they've been outside like 15 seconds, and I hear them screaming and running back inside. And Loren bursts through the door, slams the door into the wall, and she goes, "Daddy, there's a snake! And it's really big! And it's really long!" So, okay. And Paisley goes, "And it's poisonous!" It's like, did it tell you? How do you know? And so I got boots on because I'm from Texas and I'm walking, I'm gonna get this snake. And I go running around the corner. They're inside, still screaming. And I run around the corner where they told me the snake was, and I see red and yellow and black. And it turns out that it is big. And I'm doing the nursery rhyme, like red on yellow, kill a fellow. Red on black, yellow on black, friend the Jack. I don't know if this is kill a fellow or friend the Jack. And I'm looking at it and I'm thinking, red, this is the kill a fellow, right? This is the bad one. So boots are no longer enough. So I run into the shed and I grab a shovel and I come out and I violently and bravely defend my home from the dragon. And they all lived happily ever after. It was kill a fellow, coral snake. And I go inside and I give the brave dad speech to the girls. Girls, if you ever see a snake that looks like that again, if you see red and black, or red on yellow, or whatever the kill a fellow thing is, if you see that, I remembered in the moment, you run. You run. You come get somebody, you run if you see that. And Paisley said, "Dad, if it's okay with you, if we see a snake, we're just gonna run. We're not gonna try to figure it out and remember a rhyme. I'm just gonna run from all the snakes." Now, I thought, that is going in the Easter Sunday sermon. There's a lot of snakes in the garden of culture. And just to be safe, when I see something that looks like, you know what, this may have a tendency to affect my mental health. You know what, this may have a tendency to create some issues in my marriage. This may have a tendency to create an addiction that I don't want to be a part of. Just to be safe, if I see a snake in the garden, I'm just going to run if it's all right with you. I'm just going to run. But that's the reality that we live in that creates the problem I'm talking about today. We want to diagnose the snakes and decide if it's okay to get close to this one or not. And sometimes you're right, and sometimes you're wrong. And on the days when you're wrong, we get wrapped up in things that begin robbing us of our faith and robbing us of our victory and robbing us of our mental health and robbing us of relationships that are healthy, robbing us of believing that my future can be better than my past. And we still walk up into the church and we say, "God bless you, I'm a Christian." But we're practically atheists when it comes to our personal faith because we've been robbed by the snakes in the garden. When I see it, I just gotta run. I just gotta get myself back into his presence. I gotta get myself into the hands of the one who can, if he can raise himself up, he can raise me up. He can raise you up. Let me give you a few practical things about First Church. Let's talk for a minute. I just want to highlight a few things for you. I want to talk briefly about baptisms. You know, I was talking to Matt last Sunday. Do you know that we are not quite out of March? And we have no off Sundays. We baptize multiple people every Sunday. Do you know that before we are out of March this year, we have already baptized more people in the first quarter of this year than we baptized in all of 2023 in 3 months. Yeah, yeah. No off days. No off Sundays. It's already happened. It's already happened. Why is that? Because there's a group of people who say, "You know what? I don't want this thing to just be something in the back of my mind that I say I believe. I want to live this thing. I want my life to be different. I want my life to be better. There's some people that said, I don't want to keep trying to have it both ways. I want to be completely sold out to this thing. Let's talk about new members. Let's talk about our first steps process where people get plugged into their purpose. Do you know that culture says you don't have a purpose? That life can tell you you don't have a purpose? We fundamentally reject that. And so again, no off days. Every single Sunday, somebody is back there after the service teaching to new members and new believers, saying, hey, God created you with a purpose before you were even born. Why are we doing that? Because no off days. Because we are saying to people, you know what? It can change. It can be different. It doesn't have to stay that way forever. You are not worthless. You will not be bound forever. We actually believe that here. And we are committed to not having it both ways. We're not gonna just be believers in name only. We're gonna walk it out and commit ourselves to the purpose of Jesus Christ. Let's talk small groups. Small groups is the most ironic name, because I went to one a couple of weeks ago and there were like 65 people at a small group. It was Justin and Amanda's group. And I said, you didn't start a small group, you've started a church. And you know what it is? It's just people who are new, wanting to connect with each other, wanting to celebrate being a part of the family of God. That is what we are in the business of doing here. It's people who say, Sunday is not enough. A Jesus on a chain is not enough. I want to live this thing out on a Monday, on a Tuesday night, on a Wednesday, on a Thursday, on a Friday, on a Saturday. It's not just a Sunday thing. I don't want to have it both ways anymore. Let's talk next gen ministries. Do you know this weekend, the students of this church, when they could have been out doing who knows what, they decided we're gonna load up and we're gonna go to an Easter weekend youth convention. And so our kids, who could have been doing anything else, these young people, many of them are right here down front. You look good, guys. Y'all are looking mighty nice today. They said on Friday night, you know what? We're not going to a party. We're going to church. And when we get to church, we're going to worship because he's good. And when we get to church, we're going to preach with the preacher. And when we get to church, we're going to pray in the altar. And we're going to let God do something. Why? Because you can't have it both ways. And I'm thankful for a generation that is arising saying, you know what? My faith is not just going to be some abstraction in the back of my mind, but I'm going to live it out every day. Thankful for that on a Sunday morning. And we could talk on and on. We could talk about the dream team in this place. Hundreds of people who week in and week out are serving and making a difference in their gifting because God put it on the inside of them. And so whether they're helping you get parked or whether they're taking up the offering or teaching Sunday school or singing on the platform or 1,000 other things that you may not even know who does it, but God put a purpose on the inside of them. And they said, my life is more than just living and going through the motions and working a job and going home and going to sleep. I don't want to just have it both ways where Jesus is just an Easter thing. But every week of my life, I want to make sure I'm doing something to change somebody's life and transform somebody's life and make things better because I walked in. All of that happens every week with people who are just normal. It's normal. But they said, you know what? If Christ is raised, then everything else can change. If Christ is risen, then everything else can change. And I want to change. That is the fundamental philosophy and theology of Christianity. If Christ is raised, then even when it's over, it's not over. And that's not just for Easter Sunday, but that's for every day. And that's for every person. And that's for every situation. And that's for every family. If Jesus is raised, then guess what? I can be too. That impossibility can be too. That prayer can be answered. That door can be opened. That miracle can be performed. That sickness can be healed. If he can, I can. The cry of our culture is validate me in my dysfunction. I'm gonna be careful how I say this, but probably not too careful. That's why Easter today is sharing a day with the National Transgender Day of Visibility. Why is that? Because culture has a desire to not say, come out from among them and be different, because Jesus gives us a way to be different, but I'm going to validate you in the way that you are. That's the cry of culture. Amen. That's the cry of the world in which we live. I want to validate you just the way that you are. You can stay that way. Jesus says, hey, I don't want you to stay that way. There's a better you. There's a better way. There's forgiveness. There's healing. There's hope. There's transformation. You can be different. You can be different. You don't have to live in this. No, is this day for this, or is this day for this? Is this day a day of beauty, or is this day a day of ugliness? Is this day a day where I live and say, you know what? I believe in Jesus, but practically, I don't want to walk it out that way. I just wonder, looking around this room, and I know enough of you well enough to know that there are testimonies in this place. That God found me in one condition, but he transformed me into a different one. God found me as one creation, but he made me a new creation. Is there anybody in the room today that could testify what I'm preaching about and say, you know what? I'm not trying to have it both ways. I know that God is real on Sunday and he's real on Monday. I know that God was real on Calvary's Hill, but he's real at my street address today. Is there anybody that could testify and say, that is the God that I serve? This whole series started with a box of cake mix for me. It's really kind of cruel of them to put the keto-friendly cake on the front. It started with cake mix. I'm going to preach with this one for a minute because I like triple chocolate fudge cake the best. The whole concept of cake mix, and I told you I was going to get to it, right? You don't have to wonder anymore. The whole concept of cake mix is that if you've got some eggs, and I texted Jonathan Kelly Moss last night and said, hey, can y'all bring me some fresh farm eggs from Rosemary Ranchette? And I said, this is going to be like a sponsored product placement post on Easter Sunday. Look at those. They're all different colors. Kelly can tell you what chicken laid what egg based on what color it is. And if you've got some eggs, and you got some oil, and you got some water, I don't care how bad of a baker you think you are, as long as you've got this, it's going to be okay. And I thought, you know what? I've got eggs, and I've got oil, and I've got water. And so I guess what I need to do then, got it. You see, you just never know what's going to happen at First Church. I got what I need. And I said, you know what? Last night I decided I'm going to bake me a cake. I'm going to bake me a cake. And so I got this and I dumped it in. And I put in with it a cup of water. I don't know how much water this is. We're going to get there close. That's about a cup, right? All you bakers, am I doing this right? All right. There's that. And then if you got about a half cup of oil. All right. Is that good? Okay, that's good. That's good. I'm making y'all nervous, huh? And then if you got 4 eggs. I don't even know if I know how to do this. Ooh, there's 1, 2, 3, ooh, 4. All right. Kelly, I got a green looking egg. Tell that chicken thank you. Thank you for your service. And you mix that all up. You mix that all up. You get it all worked in there. You know, I don't think I put enough water. I'm going to put a little more water. The theory is that all of this in this bowl Because somebody that knew a lot more than me did some work that I couldn't do, I can take just the resources that I've got and I can mix them up. And if I will follow the directions, then this mess in this bowl will turn into something beautiful. That's the theory of cake mix. That's how it works. Cake mix says, you know what? If you can follow an instruction and you've got some water and some oil and some eggs, you can make a red velvet cake. You can make funfetti. You can make white cake, yellow cake, chewy fudge cake, classic yellow cake, spice cake, strawberry cake, triple chocolate cake, German chocolate cake, double chocolate. Well, how many kinds of chocolate cake are there? But here's what's interesting to me about this. What I bring to the equation are three things that are pretty tasteless. Like, nobody looks at this and says, man, tastes like cake. It's not. Nobody walks up to the oil and says, man, that looks... does not taste like cake. I'm not, y'all couldn't handle it. I'm not even gonna do it. I mean, but seriously, nobody goes into their refrigerator on a Saturday morning and pulls out the eggs and goes, man, whoo, that looks like cake. No, why? Because everything that you bring to the cake mix is just tasteless and broken, flavorless. That's just, it's just some resources. You know what this represents? This is just perishable potential. These don't last very long. But if I can put them into the care of cake mix, if I can take these simple, cheap, flavorless ingredients, somebody who knew a whole lot more about baking than I know said, I can take somebody who knows nothing. They're not a baker. They don't know the difference in the three kinds of chocolate. They don't know anything. But they read that if I do this, and I add this, and I'll give you this, and I'll mix it up because what's in this package is so good, then when you get done following the directions, you're going to come out of it with something that's far beyond your ability and your skill level to do it on your own. Even though I don't know a thing in the world about baking a cake, I baked a cake last night, and it came out of the pan, and it's got powdered sugar on it, and it smells pretty good, and I am not a baker, but I got cake mix. Can I tell you what I'm preaching on this Sunday morning, this Easter Sunday morning? There is a God. You don't have to have it all figured out, but if you will bring your potential and place it in His hands, He foresaw enough to know I can make beautiful things out of your mess. I can make beautiful things out of the flavor that you don't have. I've got something for you. I got something for you. There's a promise implied in the simplicity of cake mix. Somebody who knew more than I did said, I'm going to make this easy for everybody. You, with your lack of self-discipline and with your lack of knowledge, if you will bring what you have that's not worth very much, and you'll combine it with what I have, then we will produce something together that is far beyond your skill and your knowledge and your resources. So let me turn you then back to 1 Corinthians 15. Verse 42, the body is sown in corruption, but it's raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor, it's raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, and it's raised up in power. It is sown a natural body, and it's raised up a spiritual body. Now, this I say, brethren, here we go. We have written the whole book of 1 Corinthians to get here. This I say, brethren, your flesh and your blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Why? Because corruption cannot inherit incorruption. Amen. You can't make cake with just this. This has got to take on a different form. Something's got to be added to it. It's got to be transformed. There are things that are worthless in us. They're not good. They're wrong. They have no flavor. They're distasteful. They are corrupted. And I said it earlier, but the ingredients of my life are just perishable potential. If I don't use it before long, it just goes bad. It sits on the shelf and spoils. But they could be something if they got transformed. And if they got combined with something else, they're flavorless, they're not good on their own, they're just raw ingredients. Nobody wants a drink of this. I promise you don't. It doesn't taste like cake. Why? Verse 53. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. The thing that isn't good on its own can get wrapped up in something and mixed up with something and stirred up with something that is so good that it transforms the very nature of the worthless thing that's in us when the corruptible takes on the flavor of the incorruptible, when the mortal takes on the flavor of the immortal. When everything in me that doesn't have anything but just a little bit of potential gets wrapped up and folded in to the joy of knowing Jesus and walking with Jesus and believing Him for more than just an Easter Sunday. So when this corruptible has put on incorruption and this mortal has put on immortality, then it shall be brought to pass the saying that says, oh, death, where is your sting? And oh, grave, where is your victory? It doesn't just look like me anymore. It's not just what I had anymore. There's some flavor that's beyond me added to my life from Christ and His cross. And it changes everything. Musicians, come help me out. Death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? We read that passage at funerals. Almost everyone. Death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? Why do we read that? It's not just a habit. It's pointing you to a reality that there is something that wants to get a hold of your life. That Jesus wants to transform you to the point that the worst moments of your life, death and the grave, just get swallowed up in victory. Amen. And on this Easter Sunday, it is not God's will for you to look at your life and just see brokenness, flavor, no value, just corruptible. Just examining my reality and seeing a graveyard of brokenness around me. Grave, you don't have the victory. My corruption doesn't have to stay corrupted. My mortality doesn't have to stay bound to a fleshly timeline. Not with Jesus. Now, if I've decided that it's always going to be this way, then the implication, Paul said, is that you're saying that Christ is not raised and we're wasting our time. But if the faith that brought you to church on an Easter Sunday morning is enough to say that, you know what, I believe Jesus was resurrected, and I celebrate that today. If you've got that much faith, then I'm telling you, you have the makings of something beautiful on the inside of you. If you'll just give it to Jesus and say, you know what? I'm ready for corruptible to put on incorruption. I'm ready for mortality to put on immortality. Will you stand with me right now? Even I can make a cake. That's what Paul essentially said at the beginning of chapter 15. He was even seen by me. And he says, I'm not even worthy to be a disciple. I was persecuting all of you people. And he even showed himself to me. You chased down, I preached about it a couple of Sundays ago, but you you chase down the writings of Paul and you see his frailty and his failures. You read in Romans of him saying, I'm fighting a war in my flesh. I want to do good, but I keep doing the wrong thing. It's that Paul saying, he even revealed himself to me. He showed himself to all these other people that are, you know, they're at like peak spiritual condition. But he saw me and he said, I'm going to reveal myself to him. And now I'm going to preach what I've seen to you. If that kind of faith can bake a cake, don't you think it can rescue a messy life? Don't you think it can change the trajectory of a family? I know you got questions. I know you got problems. And I know you can't wish them away or just say, oh, I believe and it's all going to be. Some days it's not all okay. But as long as you're breathing, if that same Jesus that we celebrate today, if he was raised from the dead, if he came out of the grave, then as long as you are breathing, there's hope. As long as you are breathing, there's a reason to hold on to the faith that God can work it out for your good. He can take the ugliness of your life. He can take your lack and he can say, you know what? I can do exactly what I need to do with that. He makes beautiful things out of dust. Will you bow your head with me right now? I want you to close your eyes. I'm going to pray for you in just a minute, but I want you to get a mental image in your mind first. When your Bible opens, Jesus is speaking the universe into existence. He creates this and he creates that. He creates animals and plants and trees and creates light and all these things. But the very first physical act of God, the Bible said he reaches down into the dirt, into dust, and he forms man. Everything else, he spoke to form it. But when it came to you, he got his hands dirty. And he took something worthless and said, I'm going to shape this and I'm going to mold this. So that's why we say again at funerals, dust returns to dust. You are just dust. There's nothing of inherent value in any of us. We're not made of things that are full of wealth and full of fame and full of value. We're just dust. But Jesus Christ at the beginning said, I'm going to get my hands dirty with this dirt. And I'm going to give this dirt a chance to choose me. That's what Calvary was all about. You, just as limited resources, just as dust, having the choice and the chance to say, God, I'm going to give my life to you. With the hope and to take the chance that you could make something beautiful out of me too. So I'm going to pray for you right now. And to be quite honest, there's not even room for you to move forward on this day. The room is too packed. I'm not even going to give a traditional altar call today. But we're going to turn the area where we are as a place of prayer. This whole room is becoming a prayer room right now. And I'm going to begin praying for you. And I'd like you to begin praying for you as I do. And you to begin praying for your family and your future and your situation. And I believe in this place, we're not going to be here much longer today, but I believe in this place, the God that we were here to celebrate on Easter Sunday is about to become the very personal God of your own life and your own story in this place. And if you're in this place today and you haven't been baptized and you'd like to, we would love nothing more than to baptize about a dozen people on this Easter Sunday who say, you know what? I want this to be more than something I am in name only. I want to put my faith into action. If that's you, we'd love to talk to you over here to my right after service about baptism. Bow your head and close your eyes with me right now and let's pray together. Lord Jesus, God, I thank you for the miracle of Easter. I thank you that I know that resurrection is possible, but it's not only possible from a garden tomb over 2,000 years ago, but it's possible for me today. It's possible for my family. It's possible for my situation. It's possible for my future. God, I thank you that you, from the beginning of time, you looked and you saw me. You saw me as I am. You saw me with my lack of resources. You saw that I had nothing worthwhile to offer you. And in spite of who I am, and in spite of my lack, you said, if you'll just give me what you have, no matter how flavorless it seems, no matter how close to going bad it seems, if you will give it to me, then the same power that brought me back to life is ready to bring you into a new life and into a new future. God, I thank you for being that God and that Savior to all of us in this place today. God, I thank you for the miracle of Easter, but I thank you that it's my miracle. God, I thank you that when you went to the cross, when you took stripes on your back, and when you took nails in your hands, and God, when you bowed your head and died, and when you were buried in a tomb and a stone was raised over you, and everything said it was over, God, I thank you today for the revelation that what looked like it was over was really just the beginning of everything. It was the beginning of my story and the beginning of my tomorrow and the beginning of my miracle and the beginning of my answered prayer. God, I don't know why you would love me enough to do that, but I thank you that you did. I thank you that you made a way and that you brought me back. And that you opened the door that I could know you on Easter, yes, but not just on Easter, but every day. And that the God of Calvary, that the Jesus of the cross and the Jesus whose cross hangs on a chain all over this nation today has become the Jesus in my heart that changes the way I live and changes my outlook and changes everything about my future and my family and my path. God, I thank you that you are that Jesus today. You're not just a Jesus of a story, not just a Jesus that we celebrate from afar, but you're the Jesus that we know and that we worship and that we love and that we give ourselves unreservedly to in this house today. I thank you for being that Jesus to me on Easter Sunday. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everybody said amen. Here's what I want you to do to end this day. If you're by family, I want you together with your family. If you're by a friend, if you want to, put your arm around their shoulder. We're going to move back into just a little moment of worship before we end this day. We're going to keep praying. But I would challenge you right now, turn your attention to Jesus Christ and say, God, I thank you for speaking to me. And God, I pledge from this day forward that I'm going to try to be different. I'm not just going to be a Sunday, I believe in Jesus, but I'm going to be a Monday, I walk with Jesus kind of Christian. If that's your prayer and that's your cry, I want you to just begin to talk to him all across this house right now. I prayed for you. Now you pray for you. Thank you, Jesus.
By your Spirit, I will rise. From the ashes of defeat, the resurrecting King is resurrecting. In your name I come alive to declare your victory. The resurrecting King is resurrecting me. By your Spirit I will rise from the ashes of defeat.
Spirit, I will rise from the ashes of defeat.
today and you would like to be baptized, I know it's Easter Sunday, we won't take long, but if you'd like to be baptized, we'd love to talk to you. Right over here, Matt's got his hand up. He'd love to talk to you today on Easter Sunday. Imagine the story you could tell. I went to church on Easter Sunday one way, but I went home a completely different way when I realized that the resurrecting King is resurrecting me, raised to life with Christ our Savior. Listen, thank you for being here today. I want to pray over you one more time before we leave this place. And I pray that God's with you when you leave here. I know you got plans, I know you got family gatherings, and I want you to have a great time. But I hope you remember until you close your eyes tonight that the reason we celebrate is not so that Jesus would be a story, but that so that Jesus would be real in my own life and change the way I live tomorrow. Bow your heads and let's pray together one more time. God, I thank you for this amazing church family. I thank you for this amazing group of people. God, I pray that your blessing would rest on every home represented in this place and those watching online. God, I pray that every person who gathered with us today would walk out of here with a testimony that we are blessed going out and we are blessed coming in. God, I pray that your blessing would overtake them as they go from this place, that you would go before them into this week, and that, God, they would find reminders of your goodness and reminders of your grace all throughout the days ahead as we remember that you are more than the Christ of a cross and you are more than the Christ of Easter, but you are the Christ who walks with me into my Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday, and God, I thank you for that. God, go with us from this place. Walk with us every day. Let us become more like you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we pray. And the work is done in Jesus' name. Will you lift up one more shout of praise? If you know he's good and you know it's a happy Easter indeed. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Last thing, God bless you. Thank you for being here. I want to tell you, be back next Sunday. We've got the producers of The Chosen here as we kick off The Chosen series. It's going to be a life-changing Sunday that you do not want to miss. We're going to hear them talk about the heart of why they chose to tell the story the way that they did. And God's going to do a great thing in this place. You better get here early and find a seat. It's going to be just like today. Get here quick. Bring somebody with you. We're going to have an awesome time. God bless you. Thank you for being here. And happy Easter, everybody.